When you hear Diana Ross sing, you know it's Diana Ross.
The voice, unforgettable. The moves, indelible.
She just goes for it.
Diana Ross.
She set the standard for every pop culture diva in the past 40 years.
Soulful sounds that moved and changed a generation and never went out of style.
This was the female answer to the Beatles.
Along the way, plenty of drama on stage and off.
She'd take your ad-libs to your songs and she'd sing them before you got on stage.
Love in the arms of her mentor and boss.
Barry Gordy. Oh, she made us all jealous.
A love child.
They told her finally that Barry was her father.
Eventually, a relationship that threatened all around it.
She smacked him across the face, his sunglasses went flying, and she left.
Her Supreme breakup and solo career, the feud with the forgotten Supreme, Mary Wilson.
I believe that if she and I would sit together, this would probably all disappear.
A riveting story that will move you as much as her music.
She had a mission. She wanted to be a star.
That led her to the top of the mountain. In this hour, the true story of the diva who may never stop.
It's really about the music and the fans who've loved this music for so many years.
Diana Ross.
Is Headliners and Legends with Matt Lauer.
Hi, everyone, and welcome to Headliners and Legends. Call her talented, call her temperamental, and make sure you don't forget to call her Miss Ross. A singing sensation for almost 40 years, Diana Ross was the outstanding talent of the greatest girl group of her generation, the Supremes. Then her solo act propelled her to superstardom. She's a diva among divas, and from baby boomers to Gen Xers, everybody knows her distinctive voice.
Ross, the voice, the sound, the power, the presence. An enormous talent and a natural on stage, where she couldn't help but grab the spotlight. Her achievements span five decades.
Darling, to make you happy.
From her Supreme beginnings to genuine superstar. Along the way, she's ridden the highs and weathered the lows. It's a story that got its wheels in the Motor City. Detroit, 1944. Assembly lines are booming. It is in this city of new opportunity that Diana Ross is born on March 26, 1944, the second of six children in a tight-knit working-class family. Her mother, Ernestine, is a homemaker and the daughter of a Baptist minister. Fred Ross is a foreman for a metalworks company. Diana steals the spotlight early on by performing at family gatherings.
She would get up and sing You're Cheating Hard and perform, and everyone, all the grown-ups, would pass a little hat around and put money in it and things like that for her. She was a showman even at that age.
Diana's unbridled spirit and precocious manner makes her a neighborhood standout.
She was a tomboy. She was very, very outgoing, and very much involved in everything. Basically, she was the one that protected us all.
That strong personality will have a lasting impact on her adult life.
Diana Ross was very aggressive, very ambitious, enthusiastic about life. She was one of these young women who wanted a lot and would do almost anything to get it.
When Diana is 14, the Ross family moves into a three-bedroom home in the new Brewster Douglas Projects. Diana's hard-working parents protect her from poverty and crime. Money is tight, but it is a happy household.
We were kind of taught to appreciate what we had. We really never felt like, I guess, what people would label you as poor or not privileged. We felt very privileged.
She thought that, you know, she was bigger than her surroundings. She was just dying to get out of the ghetto, and very made sure people knew it.
She was outgoing and spunky, and I liked that about her.
Smokey Robinson, another future star who just happens to be Diana Ross's childhood neighbor, also notices something else. My mama told me,
you better shop around. She had this little voice, and she would always be singing, walking around singing, and I guess she was pretending that one day she was going to be Diana Ross.
But early on, it's a small, nasal-sounding voice, and it cost her the lead in her high school play. Instead, she's noted for her athletic ability on the swim team. Diana also shows a knack for fashion design. She's even voted best dressed in her class, and boys are attracted to her looks and winning personality.
She had the personality. She was outgoing. Everybody liked her. All the guys loved her. I mean, she had a choice between boyfriends, you know.
But mostly, Diana Ross wants to sing.
When she sang, people loved hearing her sing and wanted her to sing more. When we moved into the Brewster Projects, she was still a tomboy. She hung out with the boys, and they were doo-wopping on the corner, and so she would just join in with them.
Among those people on the corner are several young men who will later become the Temptations. But in 1958, they are called the Primes, and their manager wants to form a sister group, the Primettes. Another neighbor, Mary Wilson, teams up with her friend Florence Ballard and another girl. But they still need a fourth singer.
And then someone else said, well, we know that there's a girl across the street named Diane, and someone's going to go over and ask her.
Diana Ross was added to the group at the last minute, almost as an afterthought.
The group auditions for the manager of the Primes. For their first effort, they pick a catchy Ray Charles tune.
One evening, they said, well, we want you to come over to the apartment and we'll see if everybody jails. Florence said, well, I know Ray Charles' song, you know the right time, night. And we started singing, started harmonizing, night and day. And she says, it's the right time, night and day to be the one you love. You know, and so we all started harmonizing. You know, Diana came in with the top and I came in with the middle and Betty came with the bottom and Florence was singing the lead. And it was magic. It was absolutely magic that first time.
But if there is magic from the beginning, there is also friction. Florence Ballard, who has formed the group, expects to be the lead singer. But Diana Ross has other plans. Coming up, the birth of the Supremes.
It was practically inconceivable to the young Diana Ross that she would be a background singer. It just never crossed her mind.
At 15, Diana Ross, a sophomore in high school, has caught the showbiz bug. She's now performing regularly with the Primettes at sock hops and talent shows.
It was really wonderful to see all of the kids crowding around the stage, and I was out there and, you know, just watching, and it was really wonderful.
But Diana and the group want more exposure, more recognition. Diana asked her friend Smokey Robinson, by now lead singer of the Miracles, for a favor. They want to cut a record.
She called me and she said, I've got this group and I want you to listen to her sing. Tell me what you think. They were very cute and they sang well.
In 1960, Smokey Robinson helps arrange a fateful audition with a fledgling Detroit record company called Motown. It's the brainchild of a young entrepreneur named Berry Gordy, who created his new record label just 1 year earlier. Now, his group of talented young artists and songwriters are about to put Detroit on the musical map.
We just did what we did. It was part gospel, blues, pop, all the stuff that we lived.
The combination of the people he saw that had writing talent, producing talent, musical talent and onstage artistry, all of that stuff together, and he was sort of the master chef.
Every city in the world has an abundant amount of talent. We had Berry Gordy. See, that was the difference in Detroit. We had Berry Gordy.
For now, boss Berry Gordy is running Motown, nicknamed Hitsville, out of a small house located between a funeral home and a beauty shop.
We were nervous to go to audition for Motown, but we were also very confident. And that was all of us. You know what I mean? That was all of us. We were all very confident.
They sing their version of the Drifters' There Goes My Baby. But Berry Gordy doesn't care for the Primettes' bubblegum sound. And much to their dismay, he sends the girls home.
We couldn't believe this man had turned us down. We were so good. How could he turn us down? We were good.
Although he turns them away, Gordy takes notice of one of the Primettes, Diana Ross. She isn't the prettiest. She certainly doesn't have the best voice. But Gordy sees something else.
I'm sure that Berry Gordy saw what I saw in her before I even got the chance to record her. When she was a little girl, I saw charisma. She was charismatic.
Maxine Powell, who would later train all Motown entertainers, sees it too.
She was star material. You say, she was a diamond in the rough. Diana Ross was a diamond in the rough.
She's also determined to succeed. Diana and the rest of the Primettes pester the executives at Motown.
We hitchhiked to Motown every single day. I mean, every single day and sat on the steps. Pretty soon, we were inside and we were like the girls.
Finally, Diana and the girls get their first big break. Blues singer Mabel John needs some backup singers for a recording session, and the Primettes get the job. This time, Gordy likes what he hears, and he wants to sign them up. But the girls are so young, they need their parents' permission, and 16-year-old Diana has a tough time getting them to agree.
Her father was against her signing a contract with Motown. He really wanted her to go to college.
The Primettes are finally offered a contract. But before they sign, Berry Gordy insists on one last condition.
Berry Gordy said to us, I don't like the name Primettes. I think you should change it. Well, we went through the roof. It was our name. We'd had that name since 1959.
The group, now a trio, quickly chooses a name. Diana Ross, Mary Wilson, and Florence Ballard are now the Supremes. I Want a Guy, with Diana Ross singing lead, is their first Motown record in 1961. The record sinks without a trace, just like the 10 more that follow. While other female Motown groups like the Marvelettes and Martha and the Vandellas are cranking out hits, the Supremes can't seem to connect. Around Motown, they acquire a nickname, the No-Hit Supremes.
No-Hit Supremes? Oh, yeah. We were the first female group to come there. And the Marvelettes came in after we did. They got a hit record. Martha and the Vandellas got a hit record. And everyone kept coming in getting these hit records.
But my heart can't take it no more.
But 19-year-old Diana keeps pushing for stardom. When the Supremes perform with other more successful Motown groups, Diana studies the headliners and, according to one of the performers, adds their best bits into the Supremes act.
Sometimes on some of the Motown reviews, she'd take your ad-libs to your songs and she'd sing them before you got on stage. You know, some of the things that you just don't do, she would do.
Although other girl groups soar to the top of the charts, Berry Gordy refuses to give up on Diana and the Supremes. He has a vision of them as crossover stars, black singers with the pop appeal of Doris Day.
They were incredible. I knew that they had something that could take Motown and the other groups into another direction.
Finally, the legendary songwriting team of Holland Dozier Holland writes a throwaway song called Where Did Our Love Go? When the other groups pass on the tune, it's offered up to the Supremes.
Baby, 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 believe me.
They grudgingly record the song, then head out on tour.
They were unaware of what the record was doing. Because they were on a bus tour and they didn't have access to a radio. One day, like maybe a month into the tour, they started saying Supremes and people started applauding. And we had no idea who they were applauding for because we hadn't gotten much applause before.
The song begins to rise up the pop charts and it quickly reaches number one. The Supremes have a crossover hit.
And then one neighbor would turn it up, and then the whole block, everybody would have their radio blasting, so you can hear it coming through the doors.
You could hear it in the streets, you know. Baby, baby, where did our love go?
Ooh, darling.
Coming up, the Supremes seduce America.
This was the female answer to the Beatles, the female answer to the Beach Boys.
Our Love Go catapults the Supremes to stardom in 1964. They quickly follow up with more number one hits. Baby love, my baby love, and as more radio stations play their music, mainstream America begins to catch up with the Supreme sound.
There were certain DJs like Dick Clark who was able to kind of cross over. They started playing the music on the radio, and we made it okay. The Supremes and Motown made it okay to listen to our music.
But Berry Gordy wants to take the Supremes beyond radio to the ultimate national stage.
Diana Ross, Mary Wilson, Florence Ballard, here they are, and let's hear it.
On December 24th, 1964, millions tune in to the Supremes' debut performance on The Ed Sullivan Show. But it's Diana in the center who truly captivates the audience. Because I'm lonely.
There was something about Diana's appearance. She was having fun. She was having so much fun. And not to put the other girls down, because they were great, but she was having more fun than the other girls. So your eyes, you couldn't take your eyes off of that one in the middle there.
Yet her carefree style conceals the real truth about Diana's dedication to style and stage presence.
All of the artists learned and worked hard, but not as hard as Diana Ross, you see. And she would stay behind and then just work on whatever it was and until she got it perfect.
It's that pursuit of perfection that helps propel the Supremes to stardom.
When you're a teenager and something as phenomenal as that happens to you, and people say, well, did you know something different was happening? Well, of course we did. You know, we went from being broke to being, you know, just on top of the world. I need love, love, to ease my
mind. I need to find, find. Over 4 years, they have 10 number one hits. Club dates are sold out for months. They're the hottest girl group in the world. Love is here.
And oh my darling, now you're gone. This was a female superstar group. This was the female answer to the Beatles, the female answer to the Beach Boys. Set me free, why don't you, baby?
Get out my life, why don't you, baby? I mean, they were huge at this point. They were performing with Bing Crosby and with Ethel Merman, and they were doing Fats Waller medleys and Cole Porter and Irving Berlin and Rodgers and Hart.
Rock-a-bye, your baby, with a Dixie melody. Oh, when you croon, croon a tune from the heart of Dixie.
But almost immediately, the Supremes feel the effects of fame as their whirlwind touring schedule leaves no time for personal lives.
Our lives in entertainment is all we have, really, now. We have a family. I don't mean to say all we have, but we've grown up in it, and we enjoy it, and this is our on and off stage life.
There's also rising tension building within the group. As success grows for the Supremes, their image, shaped by Berry Gordy and his writing team, becomes more centered on Diana Ross.
Diana was the lead singer, and there was not going to be any changing of that. They were not going to alter this successful sound.
The tension among the girls is not helped by a new development. During a European tour in 1965, Diana and Berry Gordy become romantically involved.
Oh, she made us all jealous. But, you know, we were kind of happy that Berry had fallen in love. He had a lot of women, but he really loved Ross. You could tell he really loved her.
But for 21-year-old Diana and 36-year-old Berry, it's a volatile love affair. Their relationship will prove to be a combustive mix of personal feelings and professional goals.
When you're pushing a star like Diana, and I had a goal, and we had to push hard, and she wanted me to push her hard. When I pushed her hard, we would fight about it, but when I didn't, she was unhappy.
See, Berry wore many hats for her. He was a mentor and a molder and an advisor, and I understand her loving him.
But Barry and Diana's complex relationship begins to strain her bond with the other Supremes, and soon, friction between Diana and the rest of the group reaches a breaking point.
It was probably in 1966, early, that, you know, signs started showing that, wait a minute, it's not only lead singing, but it's preferential treatment, you know what I mean?
Barry's preferential treatment of Diana is especially hurtful to Florence Ballard, who had once dreamed of being the lead Supreme. Her dejection soon gives way to anger. She starts to drink, and she fights with everyone around her.
It was obvious to everyone in the Motown family, and probably to 85% of their fans, you know, that she was destroying herself, you know.
After a rash of subpar performances and backstage tirades, Barry decides that something drastic needs to be done. In April 1967, Barry Gordy calls a meeting. It's decided that Florence will leave the group.
There was no time for sentimentality and romanticism. You know, this was business, and they needed to move on it. So they put Florence out of the group. Cindy Birdsong came into the group, and the name was changed to Diana Ross and the Supremes.
Over the next 2 years, Diana is pushed to the forefront. For Barry Gordy and Motown, it's strictly a business decision.
You got more money. Promoters paid you more money because you had a feature person in your act. So that was how that happened. We became Smokey Robinson and the Miracles. They became Diana Ross and the Supremes.
But not for very much longer. Coming up, Diana Ross leaves the Supremes behind.
What we had dared to dream as little girls was no longer.
This is Headliners and Legends with Matt Lauer.
The 1960s are spectacular pop music years, and the Supremes are a big reason why. With 10 consecutive number one hits in 3 years, they sell more records than any other female group. Overall, second only to the Beatles. As the decade ends, Ross embarks on a new solo career, but there is a question. Can she continue the chart-topping magic on her own?
This love we're contemplating is worth the pain of waiting.
For the last few years, Barry Gordy has been showcasing Diana Ross over the other Supremes. The group soon learns the reason why, to start a solo career.
They read in the newspaper that Diana was leaving the Supremes. That's how they found out about it.
The news of Diana's plans to leave the Supremes is especially hurtful to Mary Wilson, who's been determined to hold the group together.
Sometimes people can change their dreams. So Diane changed her dream, and she saw something else, and she was going after that.
The last Supreme single, Someday We'll Be Together, is a huge hit, despite the fact that Diana records it without Mary and Cindy. With their breakup a certainty, the Supremes staged their farewell performance in Las Vegas in January of 1970.
Someday we'll be together. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
The last performance in Las Vegas was a very sad time for me because though Florence had already left, this meant that Diane was leaving. And it also meant that what we had dared to dream as little girls was no longer.
Nine years after signing her first contract with the Supremes, Diana steps out alone onto the stage. She's just 25. Even with producer and lover Barry Gordy to guide her, Diana is still faced with a daunting challenge. Can she make the transition from Supreme to Superstar?
You're there and you're thinking, golly, you know, there's nobody standing over there. There's nobody backing me up on this. I'm out here by myself.
In 1970, Diana cuts her first single, but sales are disappointing. Ironically, the Supremes' new single, recorded without Diana, is a huge hit.
Supremes were an instant sellout. Diana Ross was not an instant sellout.
But Diana bounces back in a big way. Her second release, a cover of Ain't No Mountain High Enough, soars to number one. It wins a Grammy nomination. Her solo career is on track. But Diana and Gordy's master plan for her solo career are coming together, just as their five-year romantic relationship is splitting apart.
Barry Gordy and Diana Ross. For a long time, I thought that I was not going to survive their relationship personally because it was volatile. It was combustive.
Diana is pregnant with what she will later reveal to be Berry Gordy's child. Despite that, she's attracted to someone new.
I remember very vividly that she said, you know, I was shopping in this store on Santa Monica Boulevard and kind of this guy came in and sort of flirted with me.
His name is Bob Silberstein, a 25-year-old school teacher and son of a wealthy garment manufacturer. Virtually overnight, the two develop a joyful romance.
He was fun, exciting, and she liked him, yes. I remember when she talked about Bob and then introduced him to the family and things like that. And then he was everything that she said.
On a whim, one afternoon, after knowing each other for less than a year, they decide to get married.
It was like one minute we were grilling hot dogs, and the next minute everybody had zoomed home to get a bag, and we were on a plane to Las Vegas. I think it fell to me to kind of call and deliver the news to Berry Gordy, which was like, ouch.
No longer romantically involved, Diana continues to rely on Berry Gordy for career decisions. They're able to put aside their traumatic personal relationship, and they reach for the next new thing, feature films.
I think Mr. Gordy understood that Diana Ross could not just go on being Diana Ross. She had to do something dramatic, and Lady Sings the Blues was that thing.
Gordy produces the film, and he's banking on his number one star to turn Motown into a hot Hollywood property. Diana is cast as Billie Holiday, the legendary jazz singer and heroin addict.
I remember how many people thought, what a choice. Diana Ross, this pop star playing this great blues jazz artist. Well, what are we talking about? It's a terrible idea.
But Diana, under Gordy's guidance, delivers a deeply affecting and dazzling performance.
Ain't nobody's business if I do.
Everyone talks about the on-screen chemistry between Diana and co-star Billy Dee Williams.
Whenever we had love scenes together, Barry always used to get very upset about that because I really got into it with Diana. She has one of the most incredible mouths to kiss in the world. It was wonderful.
Although the film is released to mixed reviews, Diana wins praise for her performance. It's a huge box office hit. Diana cannot attend the premiere. She and Bob Silberstein are about to have her second child, Tracy Joy. Later, Diana is nominated for an Oscar and wins the Golden Globe for Best Actress.
Thank you. It's good to be something, you know what I mean? Thank you very much.
In 1975, Diana and Gordy follow up with a film about a fashion model called Mahogany. This time, 31-year-old Diana wants to go back to her first love and design the costumes for her movie.
What really holds the movie together is the fashions. And I know that Diana fought for the modeling montage. That montage with all the fashion and her modeling in the thing, it's the reason to watch Mahogany.
Mahogany begins shooting on location in Rome, but midway through, Diana's dream project runs into trouble. Producer Berry Gordy doesn't like what he sees, and he fires the director. Then, tensions between Diana and Gordy escalate out of control. Finally, there's a confrontation on the set.
She smacked him across the face. His sunglasses went flying. Everybody there was stunned, and she left. You know, she refused to finish the film.
Mahogany is completed with stand-ins. The movie is panned by critics, but the theme song hits the top of the charts.
Do you know where you're going to? Do you like the things that life is showing you?
Leaving Rome and her former mentor behind, Diana returns home. She spends time with her family, which will soon be growing larger.
Oh, there's a lot more of you than meets the eye.
I must show you.
With her third daughter, Chudney, on the way, Diana reveals her sensitive side to her fans.
I realize how
Aren't
much...
Aren't you glad you can get to be a kid
yeah,
now?
Yeah, how much I put on them as little people. You know, how, you know, really, discipline is one thing, but then letting them be children is another thing. It's very important.
Coming up, in the mid-70s, Diana Ross seems to have it all. But tragedy is about to strike. By the mid-70s, Diana Ross, achieving success with both music and movies, is a bona fide superstar. Her career is soaring. But back in Detroit, childhood friend and ex-supreme Florence Ballard's life is crashing.
It was not easy because to see Diane moving on and to see Florence, her whole, not just her life, I mean her soul, Florence's soul was totally, it was tormented.
The drinking that forced Florence out of the group has only worsened. And after an abortive attempt at a solo career, she winds up on welfare. On February 22nd, 1976, the torment ends. Florence is found dead of a heart attack. A devastated Diana flies to Detroit to attend the funeral.
Just very sad. Wishing that there was something that could have been done to make it not happen.
Florence's death forces a reunion between Diana and Mary Wilson, who have barely spoken since the Supremes' breakup. The media circus only escalates the tension.
The two, you know, Supremes stood there looking down in the coffin at Florence. I mean, and there were probably no words to express the, you know, the sadness that they both felt at what had occurred, yet they never spoke to each other.
Diana's personal pain continues. Her marriage to Bob Silberstein is souring, a casualty of her struggle to balance home life and career. And soon, Diana decides to make drastic changes. Not only does she leave her husband, she begins to challenge Berry Gordy's influence on her life. She moves to New York.
She was looking to break away from something that's been very much a part of her life, and she was really trying to really find out who she was.
At 34 years old, Diana stars in her third film, The Wiz, an urbanized remake of The Wizard of Oz.
Come on then, ease on down.
It's about looking inside yourself. I think that's why the role of Dorothy in The Wiz was so appealing to her. That's why she wanted to play it. It reflected what was going on in her life.
But if Diana sees parallels between her life and that of Dorothy in The Wizard of Oz, the public does not. The movie is a commercial flop. Yet Diana Ross keeps moving.
When show business knocks you down and kicks your butt, you have to have that wherewithal to get back up and put your dukes up and keep on going.
And it's clear that she does.
It's my turn to see what I can see.
Diana soon begins dating again. She has a brief relationship with actor Ryan O'Neill, and then with outrageous rock musician Gene Simmons of Kiss.
She was dating. You know, she was a grown woman with three children, you know, who was just beginning to live her personal life. Prior to this, she had to invested everything into her professional career. By 1980, she was interested in learning about herself.
As part of that, Diana decides she must also take control of her professional career. That means a full split with Berry Gordy. After 20 years of working side by side with Gordy, Diana makes a historical decision. She breaks with Motown and signs a multi-million dollar contract with RCA.
It was an absolutely devastating moment for those of us who remained behind. More devastating, of course, for Berry Gordy than anybody, but
It was a really rough time.
But not for Diana. Her first non-Motown album quickly goes platinum, and she earns an Academy Award nomination with Lionel Richie for the title song of the film, Endless Love. At 37, Diana Ross is truly out on her own and seemingly on top of her game. Coming up, a Supremes reunion and the concert in Central Park. She faces the music, but can she weather the storm? In 1983, 13 years after leaving the Supremes, Diana agrees to reunite with the group for a Motown 25th anniversary special. By now, Diana and Mary Wilson's strained relationship is well documented, but the two are suddenly thrust back onto center stage.
Mary and Cindy.
When these two women joined forces on stage at Motown 25, there was no way it wasn't going to erupt into anything that was not going to be historical.
So we come, she's done all the movies, she's been become a big star, and there I was, you know, still with the Supremes, and then we come face to face, and we had no rehearsal, and we came on the show.
But it's a listless performance. And worse, Diana and Mary are having a hard time sharing the spotlight. Off camera, Diana pushes Mary's hand away from the microphone during Berry Gordy's introduction. It's an awkward moment, and it fuels speculation of a rift. Just a few months later, Diana Ross proves she's still a solo act. It's a beautiful night in New York's Central Park. Fans start arriving for Diana Ross's free concert to raise money for a children's playground. But as the show gets underway, the rowdy crowd knocks over barricades, and then suddenly a freak storm blows in. The downpour soaks the audience and Diana, and lightning flashes dangerously close to the stage.
Only Diana Ross could get special effects by God, because, you know, those clips of her standing bravely facing the elements with the wind in her face and the rain coming down.
The concert is canceled and rescheduled for the next day, but scores of people are injured as they flee the downpour. Although Diana escapes unscathed, her wallet does not. The event ends up costing her $250,000. It's a rare financial misstep in a career that over the next few years would see huge increases in her personal fortune. Indeed, Diana's wealth has made it difficult to find a man she can relate to. She continues to date casually.
If the right man comes along, I love the idea of marriage. I'm absolutely a liver. I'm committed to living my life and enjoying it and going through all the barriers and all the difficulties.
But in 1985, she meets Norwegian shipping magnate Arne Næss.
Arne is a different kind of man for Diana. He was a tycoon, which he had in common with Berry Gordy, but he was also a mountain climber, and he forced her to get out and do things that she may never have done otherwise.
They marry less than a year later, and soon the 43-year-old Diana is pregnant with the first of two sons. She's ecstatic.
It was real exciting because, first of all, she had these three girls, and I guess then along comes these two boys. And it's in many ways it's a way of rekindling the youth that's in you.
Throughout the late 80s and 90s, Diana's new recordings rarely enter the top 40. But that doesn't stop the public's fascination with Diana Ross, diva, an image she continues to cultivate through her music videos and elaborately staged productions.
Reach out. Feel the power of love. Show somebody you care.
Let's talk about a word that has been used in connection with you, and that is the word diva. What does it mean to you?
I don't think it's negative. I think it's positive. I think it's a new thing for women to be powerful and in charge of their own lives.
Though her musical career is lagging, Diana achieves success by returning to the screen. She makes her dramatic TV movie debut in Out of Darkness, a drama about a woman fighting mental illness, The role earns her a Golden Globe. And in 1999, she co-stars with the young pop star Brandy in Double Platinum.
She has this incredible light that's within her that you can see it shine just when you just look at her. The smile, the talent, the way she moves, it's in her aura. It's in her walk and her step.
Despite her professional strides, Diana never strays too far from controversy. In 1999, she's briefly arrested after physically confronting a female security guard at London's Heathrow Airport.
I thought I was being touched in an incorrect way, and I tried to complain about it. I must say that it was, I was a little loud.
Shortly after the airport incident, Diana and her husband officially call it quits after years of living apart.
The divorce was very painful for her. She never thought that she and Arna would ever become divorced. And with two children, it was a very difficult time for her.
But Diana Ross continues to press on. She draws strength from the one constant in her life, performing. In 2000, she's anointed Supreme Diva during a VH1 television special.
Touch me in the morning.
And she's launching an international tour with the new Supremes. Differences with Mary Wilson have prevented a true reunion from taking shape.
I believe that if she and I would sit together, this would probably all disappear. It would still be those two little girls.
It would be wonderful if we all could expand our vision and see that it's more important than individuals, that it's really about the music and the fans who've loved this music for so many years.
We have listened to her soulful voice, watched her evolve from doll to diva. For four decades, her groundbreaking music and flamboyant style have inspired a new generation of performers.
She touched every area in her career, and I've always wanted to be a singer, an actress, a dancer, and just to see somebody who has done that and who has opened the door for so many people to make it.
And she remains a vital music legend for millions of fans.
She never says no. You know, it's like, if she makes up her mind, then she just goes for it.
She certainly has the personality and the drive and that special something that makes somebody a star. I can't tell you what it is, but she's got it.
To her fans, Diana Ross is the ultimate performer. To her critics, she's a self-centered, dominating diva. But there's little argument that Diana Ross is a rare breed, a true superstar. She's undeniably talented and ultra-glamorous. And after 40 years in show business, she remains a living music legend. I'm Matt Lauer. Thanks for watching. Her Return to Love Supremes reunion tour, which Diana kicked off triumphantly last April, is proving something of a disappointment.
Reflections are the way life used to be.
Differences with Supreme original Cindy Birdsong and Mary Wilson prevented a true reunion from taking shape, and the public responded by staying home. Ticket sales lagging, Ross has performed to half-filled venues. Some shows have even been canceled. And now, Ross says, the promoters are pulling the plug on the entire tour, a charge the promoters deny.
I believe that if she and I would sit together, this would probably all disappear. It would still be those two little girls.
We have listened to her soulful voice, watched her evolve from doll to diva. For four decades, her groundbreaking music and flamboyant style have inspired a new generation of performers.